keep yourself unmuted.
Keep myself unmuted.
Yeah.
Great. Super. Welcome everyone back to another afternoon tea with docs. If we haven't met before, my name is Dr. Linda. I'm an emergency medicine physician, and I'm here with my lovely co-host, Dr. Erica, who is the GP from the West Midlands. And we are both lifestyle medicine physicians. It's so lovely to see so many faces joining us once again on Zoom. And if you haven't known about our show before, well, we are here on Sundays at 5 p.m. UK time, bringing you world-renowned health experts like our guest today, Dr. Kai Koch, with the mission to bust medical misinformation and share practical evidence-based lifestyle advice that you can implement right away to help you prevent, treat, and reverse chronic diseases in a supportive community setting. After the interview, if you joined us here on Zoom, you will be able to speak to us and our guest expert off camera to ask your burning questions. You can join us on social media and say hello on Instagram, Facebook, and LinkedIn by searching for the handle Afternoon Tea with Docs. Say hello and let us know how your lifestyle journey is going. Our events and community is accessible free of charge and always will be to make sure that health is freely accessible to all. But if you would like to support us, you can buy us a cup of tea or become a monthly supporter by visiting the link in the chat or in the comments on YouTube.
Today, we're speaking to Dr. Kai Koch, who is an emergency doctor, emergency medicine doctor based in London. Having recently completed a master's in sports, exercise and health at UCL, Kai focused his research time looking at emergency doctors' own physical activity behaviours and perceptions. And as a member of the British Society of Lifestyle Medicine, Kai is an advocate of lifestyle medicine, in particular using movement as medicine to help both prevent and treat chronic disease. Welcome, Kai.
Welcome, Kai. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having me back again.
Yes, it's very special to us because you have kicked off Afternoon Tea actually just a year ago. So to have you back here is a very special honor. Thank you for joining us again.
No, thank you. It's so good to be back.
Well, as I'm an emergency medicine doctor as well as you are, it is truly a personal treat to talk to you about the current difficulties that we are facing, both in lifestyle medicine and how we bring that into the emergency setting. So I would love to kick off today's show on learning a little bit about you to set the setting and why did you become an emergency doctor?
So I'll give you a quick fly through. I was actually born in South Africa and then lived there for about until I was 10 or so. Then we moved over to the UK. And I did my training in Nottingham in the UK. And why did I really want to do medicine? It's a question that I think I only really managed to find the answer to when I started training. But I think the biggest thing for me was, and the reason actually why I'm doing emergency medicine is because I wanted to know what to do in any situation when that was really like a life or death situation. And I found, as you know, when you go through training, you're gonna jump around different specialities and that. But I felt it was the one where you could make the biggest impact, and no matter what situation was given to you, emergency medicine is the one that you've just got to deal with what's in front of you in the best way that you can. And that was the main reason why I chose emergency medicine. And then because of my background, I've been lucky to have quite a sporty background and upbringing and things. And I think a lot of it really stemmed from my upbringing. You know, we lived in a semi-rural part of South Africa, and movement was just such a normal part of everyday life. And I think that has really stuck with me. And the more I've kind of, gained from my master's and just as you grow in life, you find out, and it turns out that movement is actually really important, and it's important in so many ways. So I guess I'm just trying to spread the word of how powerful movement really can be, both in terms of medical and non-medical senses.
And you actually went on studying movement as medicine through your master's degree that you just finished. What did you learn, and why did you choose a master's degree in this field?
Yeah, so it was my master's was in, it was a broad topic of sports medicine, exercise medicine, and then it had some health and like public health side of it combined into it. And I guess from a personal level, I've always done a lot of sport. I find sporting injuries fascinating. So there was that side of it. But I think the part that I really enjoy a bit more, as I've alluded to, is about it's a topic that's called exercise medicine. And I think we could argue that maybe it should be called movement medicine, as we're learning more about it. But I think it's just there is so many benefits of it. And there is just so much that you can do that all you need is the knowledge and the information for people that you can dramatically change people's lives. And I think it's a really underutilized area of medicine that's increasingly gaining traction about just exactly what we can do with it. So managed to do that at UCL, finished it in the summer, which is great to have that behind me. And then we'll see what we can do in terms of spreading the word.
We'll talk a little bit more about movement as medicine and how you're using it in the emergency setting. But I would love to talk about the study that you have done last year and what are the points that you have learned, if you share that with us.
Yeah, so we had to do a dissertation as part of the master's, and we had to do a research project essentially. So I looked at a London emergency, the area that I work, cohort of doctors. And we did a study looking at their own personal exercise behaviors, physical activity characteristics. And the second part of the study was looking at their prescribing habits from an emergency setting. So we ended up getting a total of that we could include in the study of 75 doctors that took part. And it was over a 6-week period. We did a online questionnaire that was based on a validated, just called the GPAQ, the Global Physical Activity Questionnaire, which is one of the most recognized validated questionnaires looking at physical behavior characteristics in large scale populations. Adapted that to call it the emergency medicine physical activity questionnaire, because we added on a few things that were specific that we were looking for. And without boring you too much about all the ins and outs of it, I think there were some really interesting findings from it. And the big kind of three big takeaways that we took from it were that 3/4 of emergency medicine doctors in London achieved minimum physical activity guidelines. However, less than 2/3 were actually aware of such guidelines even existing, which in a medical cohort, I think that's an interesting topic on itself as to why that number is quite relatively low, I would say. The other big part is that less than half achieved muscle strengthening guidelines, and less than 1/3 were actually aware that there were even muscle strengthening guidelines in the first place. And with regards to prescribing behavior, 3/4 felt it was important to prescribe physical activity, thought it was important to, but less than 1/3 actually did. And if I'm honest with you, I think that figure is probably lower. Now, most people think, 3/4 of people meeting the guidelines is quite good, but it's the problem with when you do survey and questionnaire data, and in particular for physical activity, is that people tend to overestimate how much physical activity that they're doing, but they underestimate the sedentary behavior. So when you extrapolate that data to larger scale population studies, like Canada are very, very good with doing these type of things, what you find out is that actually only really when you adjust for the survey bias, probably 1/4 to 1/3 of doctors were only meeting physical activity guidelines. And when you think about it, emergency medicine is a pretty active role. You're on your feet up and down most of the day. So if that type of population are only reaching that, who knows how many other people are struggling to meet that, especially with lockdown and COVID and people working from home. So I thought there was the one thing I didn't mention as well, the last kind of findings, so there's 4 main parts, was their mean sedentary behavior or average sedentary behavior was 5 hours per day. So again, if you presume that they underestimate that, you're looking at 10 hours a day is what the current estimated awake sedentary behavior time is for a person. So 10 hours a day to be sedentary is quite a long time when you don't include sleeping. So some food for thought on those.
So we're concluding basically that very few of us knew as doctors that there is a guideline for exercise that we could use to treat our patients. And even less of us are the even if we know about it, even less of us who actually prescribe it.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Exactly. Yeah. And I think there's loads of reasons why that's the case. And, you know, picking your guys' brains would actually be would be really good. And maybe that's a discussion when you know, if the audience have any ideas about how they would want healthcare professionals to engage with, you know, the public about increasing these in physical activities is one thing. Yeah, it's something that we need to really spread the word more about, not only amongst, obviously, amongst patients, but amongst healthcare professionals as well. You know, there was a, Erica, you might have heard of the study, and I'm hoping it was done over 10 years ago, and I'm hoping it's very out of date, but there was a study that was done in the UK that showed 80% of GPs didn't know about physical activity guidelines, and 72% weren't discussing them at all. So I'm hoping that figure is massively elevated, and I'm hoping it's improved these days. But it just goes to show that really we're not very good at prescribing it, we're not very good at talking about it, and sometimes we're not very good, or we're getting worse really at achieving the guidelines.
And this is in a setting where we know that there's only 12 people that we need to speak to actually encourage one person to take on physical activity for 12 months. So it's the question, how many people do we need to treat or converse about exercise to actually have a positive outcome? This is in comparison to smoking, where we need to speak to about 35 to 120 people to actually achieve a positive outcome of smoking cessation. Yeah. So it's very, very useful if we actually engage with our patients, right?
Yeah, exactly. And you know, one thing that some of the data from, again, from another UK study said that when they did a survey around, was saying that one in four patients, if they were advised by a healthcare practitioner to do more exercise or physical activity, should I say, that they would do it. So, you know, if every fourth patient, I think that would be, relatively speaking, in medical terms, that would be a good hit rate.
And we were talking about association links between outcomes with Erica before. We have a clear bridge association between smoking and lung cancer. And we very often in our history taking, in our social history taking, we ask about how much do people smoke, and we immediately advise them on smoking cessation. It became a cultural norm to go to, right? Would it take much longer to do the same thing with physical activity to create these links between the positive effects of physical activity and chronic diseases? What do you think?
Not at all. And I think, and that's something that at the hospital I was working at when I was doing all this research, and we were talking about it a lot more because it was happening. Well, it was happening all over London, but it was kind of the focus of where I was working. And there was quite a few people, just by having conversations amongst the doctors working there, we almost got to a phase of getting people to add it onto their social history. When you ask about alcohol, when you ask about smoking, one of the things it's a quick question, it takes 2 seconds. Just say, you know, how much movement do you do every day? And you can get a very quick screening test to do it. And then that can prompt the conversation to going a bit further. I mean, one of the things I used to do, and I've deliberately done it, you can probably see in the back of my screen there, is my cycling helmet. And sometimes we'd be able to have rooms, and I used to sometimes at one hospital have a particular room where I know I could use all day. So I would deliberately, instead of leaving my cycling hat in the locker room or something, I would leave it in the corner on the floor. And that was also another prompt, because you'd be amazed how many people say, oh, is that your cycling hat, or is that just in the room or something? And it's just it's a prompt to start and initiate those type of conversations. That's a really easy way, for example, of doing it.
While you guys are here on Zoom, do you let us know, would you like us to address physical activity if we saw you in our clinical practice? And do you have experience where doctors are actually had this conversation with you? Would love to know. Also, if you're on YouTube, do leave a comment. Now, you said about the prompting with the cycling helmet. We were thinking, when are we going to start prompting our doctors with a prescription for lifestyle medicine and physical activity? Do you think that's around the corner?
I hope it's around the corner. And I think it's, you know, as we were talking, I think it's going to take all of us on the ground level to just start initiating these things. Hopefully they catch momentum because people truly see the benefits of it. And then, you know, it'll spread and grow and evolve over time. And I think I love the idea of almost like people associate prescription with the drug, right? So if you could literally physically write down what you want someone to do or what the next steps are, that is their prescription. It's still a prescription. And I think it means more when it's written on paper as well. So I think that's a great idea and something we should really start doing. And we need some more, you know, media press and coverage, and just start small and hope it snowballs. And I think it will.
So before, when I am in practice, I actually just rip off a piece of paper and write a prescription on it. Having that prescription pad with the lifestyle medicine, physical activity stamped on top of it would definitely also prompt not only myself, but my colleagues, I think, to look up the guidelines and to know that there are actually guidelines for it.
Yeah. And I just to jump in there as well, one of the things that I looked at, and again, I got some actual data from this, from my research, was I asked doctors, what are the barriers for prescribing? And the two big things that came up was, one was lack of time. And one was lack of confidence, because people just aren't that aware of the guidelines. There was a third one, which I thought was quite an interesting one, was they thought patients wouldn't be interested, which I thought was really interesting. And that is a perceived, made up barrier, right? That's not even real.
Thank you for bringing that up, because both of my colleagues and also often patients might say, yeah, but we don't want, or our patients don't want to hear that they have to work for their health. But in my experience, it couldn't be further from the truth. When I address the link between physical activity and how to do it in a smart prescription, so how much what type of exercise, how many times a day, for how long, when I write it down like that and I create a clear link with the disease with which they are presenting, my patients are very perceptive to it. It's yeah. Only that we are very vague nowadays. We just tell them, go and exercise. Of course, with that, not very many people know what to do with it. But if you give them a specific dose-related prescription, they're very, very positive and receptive to it. Is that the same experience that you are seeing?
Yeah, 100%. And I mean, I think something that we should just discuss, and I think I've just seen someone who's Donna Holt, I think you just put it in the chat as well, is that I think people associate the words of physical activity, exercise, movement. I sometimes feel like there's all these different words going around. And when I started really looking into this, I just used the word exercise all the time. That's then migrated down to physical activity. And then now I actually prefer to use the term movement, because you don't need to be, if your baseline is nothing, you don't need to be making and meeting the 150 minimum guidelines. And that it doesn't matter what you're doing. If you're doing something and you're trying to progress, I think that is the most important thing. And everyone has got their own individual baseline. You know, Moving Medicine recently released a consensus statement this year. And that was one of there were kind of like five key topics on it that they touched on. And I'll go through them. It was, in any population, obviously, yes, there are exceptions of if you have severe disabling heart failure, for example, which means you potentially can't even walk through, you can't even walk a step or something fine, and you're bed bound. That is different. You can argue that's a separate topic. You could still move, and there are things that you could still do regarding movement for that. But generally speaking, for 90% of the cases, benefits outweigh the risk, whether you've got the disease and you are, you know, symptomatic from it, or even if you're doing it as a preventative measure, benefits outweigh the risk of any adverse events. The perceived risk is something that we talk about, and that's a particular thing that they mentioned, that people feel that there is an increased risk. And yes, you know, there is, it is well known that when you are actively exercising, there is a temporarily increased risk of, for example, a cardiac event happening, but it is still so relatively small. And the overall gain that you'll get over a period of time as your body adapts to that massively outweighs that risk. So those are those two topics. One of the things that they acknowledge is that you can't just tell someone to exercise. You can't just say, oh, look, you're not exercising enough, go move more. You need, as you said, it's an individualized prescription to that person's lifestyle and the way that they're living, tailored to them so they can advance from the level that they're starting at. And then the last point was about getting medical review. If you have symptoms, if your symptoms are getting worse, despite the guidelines and the screening saying that you're okay to start or continue, then you do need to have medical clearance. And that is, we can come on to that. And there's I think we were talking about it before, the American College of Sports Medicine. I think I've got a really good, simple kind of flow chart that they put in an infographic about how you can progress, when you need medical clearance, when you don't need medical clearance. And it doesn't go into detail, but it's just a really good starting point about how to progress. So if there's any healthcare professionals out there that haven't seen those, I think the Moving Medicine Consensus Statement and the ACSM infographic on, you know, screening for doing physical activity are really good starting points.
Those are great points. Thank you for sharing those. So we have to repeat this. Is it more dangerous to not advise our patients to exercise, or is it more dangerous to advise them to do so?
So I think, in, you know, this is my opinion, I think we should be, there's obviously going to be a case where someone shouldn't be exercising, right? You've got symptomatic severe heart disease. No, you shouldn't be going for a run, or you've got, you know, an irregular heartbeat that, and you've been advised not to do it. There are cases, but for 99% or 98%, whatever you want to call it, I think you could argue doing more harm than good by we're not discussing these things that we should be discussing. That if physical activity was, you know, a tablet that we could take, everyone would be on it. It would be in the water. Everyone would be doing it. So why aren't we doing something that's freely available to everyone that can reduce your mortality risk by overall 20 to 30%? It's the fourth, you know, the fourth most, fourth on the list for risk of overall mortality these days is physical inactivity. So,
Erica, would you show that list just to support this information of how many diseases can physical activity actually treat?
Can you see this?
Yeah, we can see that.
So this is more on the prevention side of conditions, the risk of developing these conditions could be lowered by us just simply being more active. And this is the guidance from the Chief Medical Officer in the UK, and looking at type 2 diabetes. Actually, the Moving Medicine resources states that the risk is reduced by up to 50%, and heart disease, stroke by 35%, falls and depression by 30%, joint pain, back pain, like we discussed last week, very, very common problem. The risk of developing those can be reduced by up to 25%. And even certain cancers like colon cancer and breast cancer, their risk can be reduced as well up to 20%.
And I think one thing just to mention while you've got that on there is, I don't know if anyone's familiar with this version, there is the old infographics as well. And the reason that they've put the build strength into the middle of it, which is it's interesting because it's the same thing that I found in my study, is because the person who created this, the group of people for the UK CMOs, put strength in there because the trend for strengthening has actually been going down as well. So that was deliberately put in the middle to try and highlight that that's something that we need to do. And I think there's going to be a lot of work done on that. There is next year, I think they're revisiting these guidelines and they're starting a working committee to update some of these as well. So it's going to be an interesting space to watch. As to how they change it, I think they're going to go a lot more into strength work and in particular balance work, which is what the current WHO update in 2020 actually went into for those over the age of 65. Not only should you be doing your 150 minutes, they said actually, or your 75 are vigorous, you can consider going doubling it up to 300. And you should be doing your strengthening work twice a week. And for those over the age of 65, should be doing 3 times a week balance type work as well. And again, that really just comes down to, I know you mentioned it with Johnson and Charlie over the last couple of weeks as well, but comes down to sarcopenia, so muscle loss with age, as well as reducing the risk of falls. So that's a whole nother topic in itself.
Guy, could you talk to us a little bit about sedentary lifestyle and how does that affect our health?
Yeah, so that's a good point, because everyone thinks that, you know, fine, I give you an example, someone, you know, the average office worker, say you work an eight hour day, and I don't know, sometimes then you might go to the gym in the morning before or afterwards, and you might get the bus or the tube there, but you've done your hour at the gym, whatever it is that you've done, your weight session, or you're on the treadmill, or you go for a swim, or whatever you do. So that person, he or she, has ticked the box of I've been physically active that day, which is great, but then might spend the next 7.5 hours, apart from going to the toilet and going up to get lunch, sat on a chair. You might have noticed that I'm bobbing around a little bit on my chair as a side note, but that's because I'm using a gym ball to sit at home, because it's much more comfortable for me than using an actual office chair, and it's a lot cheaper and I get bored easily, so it helps me work. But the point is, that person is physically active, but they are sedentary. And I think it's really important to highlight the fact that in order to be really considered to be physically active, you need to aim to meet the guidelines as a minimum, because that's where the research shows that the health benefits come on. But I just want to tag on to that it doesn't matter if you do no physical activity, no movement relative to you, even doing 1 minute on day one and trying to build it up gradually will have a huge impact on your physiology. So, you know, it's a target to reach. Some people may never reach that. Some people may quadruple that amount, but it's just the guideline to try and, you know, you've got to have some sort of guideline out there to do it. But
I love Bath's comment here, 1% increment added on.
Yeah, it every little helps. It all adds up, and it's long-term gains and the benefits you want to get from that. But yes, you might be physically active, but you are sedentary as well. And there are sedentary behavior, even if you are physically active and you are meeting the guidelines, has been associated. In particular, there's been studies done in children that particular health outcomes are still adversely affected because you are sedentary and you're not active. So it's a really good point. And there was a episode, you know, Daryl Edwards, who's he's prominent on Instagram as well, and he's been on TV recently. And there is, they call it the 28-2 rule. I don't know if you guys have heard, if anyone's heard of that at all.
No.
And it was a study that was done that basically, it found that is a formula. So for every half an hour, say, of a working day, you should try and prioritize it so that 20 minutes you're sat at a chair, 8 minutes you are standing, and 2 minutes you are moving. So if you extrapolate that into the average 8 hour day, all you're really looking at is to be standing for an hour, or roughly just over an hour, and moving for just over 15 minutes of that 8 hour working day. And even that on its own, if you discount any other physical activity or movement that you do, has found to reduce, improve productivity, reduce stress, improve physical health and mental health. I don't have the exact figures on exactly the degree of that, but it was significant. And that is, you know, everyone, I think standing desks are becoming quite popular, and that would be, I think that's really achievable to do. You could easily at work, you know, obviously there might be reasons why you can't stand, for example, but you know, the average person is like, could easily have a standing desk. And I know a lot of people are like, oh, we know I don't have the desk to be able to do it. Well, you've got cardboard boxes. I know people who do it, use it on an ironing board, but people, you put it on the side. There's plenty of tricks that you can do to go around and do that. So I thought that was just a good little snippet that came from Daryl.
It's brilliant and very practical as well. So every half an hour, just try to stand up. Don't complicate it. Try to stand up, walk around, go get a glass of water, hydrate. You know, it's a good reminder to get something to drink. And I would like to tie this sedentary lifestyle into what we are seeing in the emergency medicine department associated with COVID and lockdown. I am definitely seeing a huge rise in heart disease, heart attacks. I was just saying, like, on a non-scientific measure, that my observation is that our heart attacks went up from 4 cases a day up to 10 to 12 cases after the 2 years of lockdown, drinking quite a lot of alcohol, being scared of going outside, exercising has dramatically dropped down. People are not even walking to their work any longer. They're working from home. So the sedentary lifestyle really has increased. And I have seen a huge rise in the department in chronic disease, acute presentations, which are, if you're not familiar, if you have heart disease, and unfortunately the acute presentation of that is a heart attack, or if you have diabetes, there are many complications that present to us, and this is very much linked with the current sedentary lifestyle. So what did you notice in your department, and what are the studies that have come out on this?
Yeah, it's exactly the same for us as well. You know, I've definitely noticed it. You know, when we kind of thought things were settling down with COVID, actually, I'm sure you found it, our workloads have actually increased, because and it's all to do really with chronic disease. Like, yes, of course, there's the accidents and everything that come into A&E, but the overload of chronic disease is, I think, in my opinion, is getting worse. It is increasing. The stats are all there for everyone to see. You know, obesity rates are going through the roof. I think it's the same. They're very similar to the, I always link the two together, the current obesity, I'm going to call it a pandemic, because it's a chronic disease pandemic going on all over the world. And I don't think you can really deny that. Imagine if we gave, you know, the chronic disease pandemic as much airtime as we gave COVID. You know, that is not to detract from the horrors of COVID, but I mean, it is a whole pandemic in itself, and we need to start doing something about it. But what I was getting to is 1 in 4 people are considered to be, in the UK, physically inactive, as are they considered to be obese. And the numbers, even, I think, even more shocking for children, is that 1 in 5 kids aren't physically active. And the problem is that then gets worse as they get older, because then the studies show that 80% of that carries through to when they're adults as well. So we've got an impending kind of chronic disease, and those are just two common diseases. I think diabetes similarly follows root amongst all those metabolic syndromes of high blood pressure, obesity, and diabetes as well. So I feel like it's going to get worse. And does anyone know what the current NHS, in terms of percentage, that is spent on preventative medicine?
0.
The annual budget. It's 5 is what they claim, actually.
Oh, wow.
5% is what they do. So I heard this from someone recently, and it kind of, like, I sat and reflected on it as well, is that we call it healthcare, but I've heard someone say actually it should be called
sick disease care,
because it's we're waiting for problems that we can solve, that we know how to solve, that we know how to prevent to happen, for us then to spend and focus all our resources and money on treating those problems, which is you're never gonna nip it in the bud. It's only gonna get worse. And what you need to do is it needs to be true healthcare, proactive, preventative healthcare, and we need to start shifting direction towards that.
And I just see Dr. Hans here, so just wanted to say hi. And he's definitely pushing towards preventative medicine for patients in America and now globally as well, with his amazing course. And thank you so much for doing that, Dr. Hans. I must note here that we and the news, the media, talk so much about the NHS being overwhelmed by the COVID cases, due to which I believed that we have had the lockdown so that we can reduce the workload on the NHS and we can cope and hopefully deliver better service to our patients, right? I think that was the idea behind it.
Yeah.
But do we ever talk about the fact that it's not really the COVID cases that we are seeing that is overwhelming us, and not only now, but for the last decade that I have been working in the NHS, but is the chronic patients that are blocking up our beds? Is the chronic patients plus a little bit of COVID that we have seen a huge rise in that is completely blocking the whole of the NHS? And still till today, we talk every day about COVID, but not a single news have ever covered the fact that our departments, our waiting areas are full of patients with heart disease, diabetes, with high cholesterol, high blood pressure. Oh God, don't even talk about high blood pressure. The last month I have seen the biggest rise in malignant hypertension that I have ever seen in my career. So I think it's such a poor representation of what we are seeing. Don't you think it's not really COVID that we should be talking about, but actually the chronic diseases, the pandemic of chronic diseases that making the COVID infection worse?
Yeah, 100%. And you know, there's been some really good studies done by Professor Mark Kamer, and they looked at a British cohort of patients in particular. It was quite a big study that was done, and they found that those who did habitual, so regular physical activity, had a decreased risk of severe COVID by 30 to 40% after accounting for confounding factors. And they ended up concluding with a bit more data that I think if elimination of unhealthy lifestyle, this is not just physical activity, but this is smoking and obesity as well. So if you just add in those two other things, would prevent 50% approximately, using extrapolated data, of severe COVID cases. I mean, imagine 50% of fully preventable things that we can do. It's you're talking huge numbers of lives saved, resources, you know, it's crazy numbers, I think.
We could have had a wonderful opportunity to inform and educate our public about preventable diseases during this pandemic of COVID-19, but we have completely missed this opportunity. It's almost as if there was an agenda to not talk about it, because you must have one if you don't even try to bring the obvious to the surface. And I often see these posters with, we are all boosted with the vaccine and I'm vaccinated, the vaccine is fantastic. But what's the point of boosting an immunity with a vaccine and talking about it when all of our patients are losing their immunity from lack of exercise and poor diet? They don't have an immune system to boost.
Yeah.
Do you see the same kind of misalignment here?
Yeah, and you know, I think kind of arguably one of the elephants in the room as well is that you know there is a widening kind of socioeconomic gap as well, and all this it's out in the open. The King's Fund recently released 2021, and they basically looked at those are in the kind of highest brackets versus the most deprived and the least deprived brackets. And the life expectancy between the two can be up to 20 years. They said 3 to 20 years was the range. And I mean, that is purely, is it a gap of education? It's a gap of, you know, quality of housing. There's so many other factors that I think play into that. And the gap's getting bigger. It's only going to get worse. So there needs to be really, you know, we're doing it from the ground up kind of level, but there needs to be some kind of top-down approach as well, so we can meet in the middle of all this going on.
And hopefully now that you're going to be an A&E consultant with so much knowledge in lifestyle medicine, you're going to be that top dog, telling them what to do to bring actual real health into our healthcare system. I can't wait.
It's platforms like yours as well, you know, that's just trying to raise all the awareness as well. So what you know, it all comes from what you guys are doing as well, really. But yeah, just kind of follow up on that point, because again, I found this like talking about, you know, the lifespan and health span. And I know, I think it was Johnson who a couple of weeks ago kind of just picked up on this topic as well. But I found, I just share the stat with you because I thought it was just baffling. So again, this is all fully available on the NHS website. But life expectancy, I think the most recent levels were 79 for a male, and I think it's 83 for a female, of which the disease-free years I'll explain it another way. So the healthy life expectancy, so your health span, if you're a male, drops by is 63 effectively. And for a female, it's 64. So essentially what that's saying is that you have, you're healthy up until then, and then you're plagued with chronic problems and things. So you have, as a male, on average, 16 years of diseased years. For a female, it's 19 years. So they've got three more years than what you'd expect. But the point is, that's 20% of your life that you are arguably independent, dependent in many ways, and so many things. That is a huge portion of life that not only you could have disease free or disease reduced, and physical activity is only one part of, you know, all the pillars of lifestyle medicine, but it's a massive part of it. And you know, you look at places like the blue zones, where you have the highest number of centurions around the world. A lot of the reason that they have such free and healthy lives, and I think is increasingly shown, is yes, it's about diet and things, but actually it's about the physical activity of what they do on a daily basis. I feel like, you know, technology has outpaced our evolution, and we just don't need to do anything anymore. Everything just gets served to us on a plate. You don't have to, you know, go collect the parcel or do anything. It all just gets delivered for you. You don't even have to hoover the room anymore. Your robot just goes around and does it all for you. So I think we almost need to go back and make life a bit more uncomfortable to really benefit ourselves.
Yes, we did mention on the last two shows with regards to that everything is just way too comfortable. And we have to go back to how we lived before. Unfortunately, our bodies are machines that need to move. And the more comfort it brings this new lifestyle, the less healthy we become. We just have to recognize that. And I just want to touch on that point where you said we are feeling so well until our 50s, 60s, and all of a sudden somebody said, well, I was okay until now. And now, why am I having suddenly a heart attack? And Dr. Hans was on previous shows who showed us really clearly how the clogged arteries from lack of exercise, smoking, and a poor diet, actually every decade you're increasing your heart disease and how it's clogged up by six, you know, by 40% of your arteries are clogged up by 50%. And we kind of have our first heart attack in our 70s. And that's what we see with our patients, everything that they present with their first heart attack in their 70s. And they're not seeing this silent killer basically being with them the whole time. And we could have stopped that with a quick prescription. And Erica, do you want to talk a little bit about why is it so important to actually talk about it in an emergency setting? Why is it an important teachable moment for us, and why we should not stop at just GP level, but also how we can teach our patients in an emergency setting?
Yeah, I think we were talking just before we came on live with Kai about why is it that for us clinicians, sometimes it feels like it's difficult to discuss this topic of movement and lifestyle choices in A&E setting, because you're so busy, right? With that, just a few minutes, you've got so many people waiting in your waiting room. It seems like it's not the right place, and it seems to be misunderstood to be a bad place to be discussing this kind of this topic.
That's like slow medicine. Lifestyle medicine is associated with slow medicine, where it's long consultations are required, but it couldn't be further from the truth, right? Because of the change cycle that happens in an acute setting. What is the change cycle,
Eric? Yeah, so let me just share my screen. This is taken from a website, but you can find the change cycle on many different sources. So can you see my screen?
Yes.
So here is the change cycle. When we talk about kind of any behavior change, this is something that we learn about the change cycle. So you need to really be contemplating change in order to make a change. And wherever you are in this change cycle, whether you're contemplating a change, preparing to make a change, already making a change, or you're maintaining a behavior change, anywhere in this cycle, you can still fall out of the cycle because something in your life might have happened and it's put a block in what you're doing. And, you know, the best of us can fall off the wagon and have to restart again. And we were just talking about this before we came on live, that actually being in that busy A&E setting, when somebody has come in with an acute problem, and the NHS is designed to deal with these episodic acute problems. And this is why we're not very equipped at managing chronic conditions. And when people come in with their acute chest pain, that is a great teachable moment. And you, Linda, and you, Kai, to spend a couple of minutes with them talking about, you know, their lifestyle. And Linda, you, and I know that you do this on a regular basis, that you just say it very plainly to them that actually these are the things that you're doing or not doing, and they are contributing to why you are sitting right here in front of me today, right?
Yes. And well, yeah. I did ask for permission before, because it can be quite, well, in a fast setting, you must be very straightforward with your patient. You don't have that opportunity to build rapport. But at the same time, I don't feel that I have the right to withhold the information, which could save them a second heart attack or the first one if they have come in with angina, with chest pain associated with this blocked artery. So I think it's very important to identify when we can speak about it, but not miss the opportunities, such important educational moments where people are open and perceptive to life-changing information. How do you perceive this, Kai? Do you identify the patients who are right for this conversation?
Yeah, absolutely. It's something I've increasingly, the more aware I've become, I increasingly do it. And, you know, spending that extra, if you know, there's motivational interviewing, and again, Moving Medicine is a really good website where you can kind of learn how to do that type of thing, but just spending a minute or two can actually have an impact. And I'm always amazed to find that no one has really ever had a discussion with someone about, for example, I'll keep it to physical activity, about their physical activity. When you can in a minute or two say, look, are you aware that, say, if you have diabetes or you've just had a heart attack or something, that your risk reduction just by being slightly more physically active is significant? You're talking 20-30%. And you know, are you aware of that? Are you currently moving? What is your current level of movement? How do you think you could incorporate that into your daily life? And I think the whole behavior side of this topic is really good. That's one kind of behavioral model, and I know the one that's gained a lot of traction is the one by Professor Fogg at I think he's at Stanford in America, and he uses the behavior model as to equal MAP, so behavior equals MAP, which stands for motivation, ability, and prompt. And you really, to get someone to change their behavior and start a habit, the book that I read is called Tiny Habits, and it's all about make it easy to incorporate new good habits into your life, and make it hard to do the bad habits. So, and it, you know, your motivation is the most, in many ways, unreliable source of trying to make you do something. That's why, for example, everyone who does takes up something in January often falls off the bandwagon, because if you've never been to the gym before, you're not suddenly going to go to the gym for an hour a day and keep that through. And it's the same with a diet or something. So if you take out the motivation side of it and you make it easier for yourself, everyone is potentially able to do some form of push-up, right? So if you say, right, my New Year's resolution is I'm going to do a push-up, even if it's a knee push-up, but you just do, say, my New Year's resolution is I'm going to do one push-up. I'm just going to do one push-up a day whilst the kettle's boiling and I'm not actually doing anything else in that time. I'm going to do one. And then your prompt is something that you do every day, which is boiling the kettle. You then do your one push-up. And then it's really important to try and build that habit that you are now attaching onto another thing that you do. Is sounds a bit cheesy, but celebrate that habit. It doesn't have to be, you don't have to high five yourself or something. It can be something you say to yourself in your head, but you celebrate that habit. And it takes you 2 seconds to do that. The point is keep doing it before you know it. And this is a real success. And the key to that is that in a week's time, you'll be like, well, I've done one push-up. So I'll just do two because one's easy now. And then you end up doing 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And before you know it, you're on 10, 20 push-ups that you thought you could have never have ever have done. And I think one of the other keys to that is you're always going to have the days where you're like, I really don't want to do this one push-up. But the point is, even if you don't feel like doing it, if you've worked up to 20, don't have to do 20, but just do one. Keep the habit going, keep it small. And then you'll be amazed that, oh, actually, you know what? I've gone down to do one. I'll just do it and get it done. And it's fine. And it's simple things like that that I think we can start the ball rolling from an acute setting like A&E, where the impact factor is actually quite high.
I think it was it last week or the week before in our non-recorded part, I was introducing this concept of a non-zero day. And I think that was quite a welcome concept of actually, you know, if you're somebody who is not used to doing anything, like you said, going to the gym for an hour a day, you're not going to go from zero to doing that consistently. And setting, you know, yourself a target of I must go for a run 30 minutes, you know, five times a week or something. Again, from doing nothing to doing that could be quite challenging for some people. So having this concept of non-zero, just do something rather than have a big target, do something. Something is better than nothing, right? And when you do that something, then celebrate it, like you said.
Yeah, just make it small, achievable, realistic, and you do something that you enjoy. You know, if you don't like doing push-ups, don't do push-ups. Do something that you. It could be as simple as doing a squat. It could be, you know, I feel like a lot of these natural functional movements that we just don't have the need to do anymore. And I think they're all, you know, when was the last time you, I don't know, had to hop over something or jump over a gate or just do any of these functional things simple? And there's so much stuff that you can do at home that you could just attach on, and it, you know, you're not going to see a benefit tomorrow, but 6 months time, and maybe when you're a lot older, and if you keep these habits up, you might not have that fall that would have broken your hip that would then dramatically change your life. So
yeah, talking about falls, I think actually I really wanted to mention this as well, that in our healthcare system, when we admit people into hospital, it's actually a very, very sedentary few days or weeks for the patients. And I was recently in hospital for an operation, and around me nobody was moving. They were lying in their bed or sitting in their chair, and the only time that you would really go and move about was when the physio came and say, let's see how you're moving today, or should we try some stairs or something. And in this healthcare system, we're not really allowing that space for our patients to rebuild their health, because a lot of people actually come out of hospital being more deconditioned. And I'm sure you see that in A&E of people who are discharged home and then they come back in because they're so deconditioned from their stay in hospital.
Yeah, 100%, you know, and with the rate of sarcopenia muscle loss, as we know, that's increasing, like, you arguably strength training is becoming ever increasingly important. And not only that, and I I'm not a nutritionist, but I know you need to increase your protein intake as well when you get older. Otherwise, you are, by, you know, it's genetics, you are going to lose your muscle mass. And eventually, you're going to get to the point that you don't have enough to be able to, you know, correct yourself if you do trip over that thing or step on that patch of ice. And it's been really icy the last few weeks. The number of people I've seen in the last week come in with falls that have completely changed their lives. And that is, you know, you can't control the ice being there per se, but you can definitely control what you can control, which is trying to do those little daily things that can make a massive impact on your long-term health.
Yeah. And one other thing I wanted to say is sometimes I think we feel like we're being kind when we offer to do something for somebody, say with maybe an elderly relative, or, you know, in hospital, we very often do things for our patients where actually they might be able to do it themselves. It may require that little bit of more effort from them, but if we take away that opportunity, just like Linda was saying last week, when somebody offered to take her heavy bags up the stairs for her, they're taking that opportunity away from her to perform that task and to build her strength.
Yeah, it's happening all over the place. And just on that note of hospitals that you've mentioned, there is a program, and I think they're trialing it at Oxford, you know, in Oxford, and it is called Active Hospitals. I don't know if anyone has actually heard of it as well, but I mean, initiatives like that are great. And I think even more important in some ways to that, because of the hugely problematic evolving pandemic of childhood chronic disease that I feel like is going to come, and I really hope we can curtail it, but is active, I think it's called Active Schools as well. And there is essentially trying to incorporate movement in the daily classroom, which I think is just so important. I think you can look up that as well. But that what they're finding is that there's more engagement from children, it's having better physical outcomes, but it's having better mental health outcomes as well. And they're actually enjoying school and productive. So I really hope that initiative catches on and expands as well, because things like that are really good.
Yeah, absolutely. In Norway, they are doing it. The forest schools and children are loving it. Kai, you have learned a lot about movement, and you have seen, unfortunately, our current sick care model, where we are feeding our patients into what I like to say the Pharmageddon through our prescription pads. It would be fantastic to turn them into lifestyle medicine prescription pads, as we were talking about it. But besides that, how do you see our sick care model turning into a healthcare model? What would be a few steps that you would like to see for the future to turn our healthcare model around?
Yeah, as I kind of mentioned before, I think it's going to take, you know, people who are like all of us in this meeting, who are interested and engaged to it. And I think on the ground level, we're having conversations about it more and more. We're doing our own things. I've started doing my own research. I've got a lot more research that I want to do, and I've got a lot more data that I haven't even used yet as well. And then building further, I think we just need to do the little things that we can to kind of just spread the news and things. But equally, I think, and I don't know if anyone has got any good answers to this, but how it really needs to come from the top down, because I'm afraid the current model is just really, it will come from the top down, but the problem is that, like when you go have your heart attack, the ship's already sailed, and we need to try and do what we can to turn that around. So I with regards to that latter part, I don't really have a good answer how it will change. And I'm hoping what we're doing here, having this meeting, things will, you know, we're doing our bit that we can do to try and change things. I think just on the specific thing regarding A&E, one of the things that kind of came back in my study that I did was teaching to healthcare practitioners and to patients. I think in particular to healthcare practitioners, something easy that we can all do. And that's something that I'm in the process of arranging at the moment. And resources. I mean, I don't know about you, but I found it, I had a look on the Moving Medicine website today, and there are some resources on there as well. But one of the things that I want to do is, I think because we are struggling with time so much, and you can argue there's a benefit of our waiting rooms being really busy, because then we can capture a bigger audience. And if we could put some posters on the wall explaining some of these simple concepts on there, and if we can get some patient information leaflets to say, I don't have time, but, you know, have a quick flick through this, and you can personalize some information on there. It just could be simple little things that we can do on the ground level to help the ball keep getting bigger?
I would love to start with, by end of February, we all come together to create a prescription pad that actually comes with a little leaflet for all the doctors to see where they can find out more about medicine, moving medicine, and how they can comfortably prescribe. That would be a great goal to have, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's a good start. And I think we just need to keep driving this kind of behavior that, you know, we just need to realize the effects of behavior and how to keep things simple and make the easier things easier and the harder things harder. And yeah, we should keep pushing for it.
And those who are watching us, we would love to hear your opinion, how you would like to see the NHS change. How would you like us to approach you as physicians on your lifestyle changes? How would you imagine a conversation that would actually support your health gain instead of just prescribing you medications? Because that is a conversation that should be had between the patient and doctor as equals, no longer as top down, as we are doing, I would say, a patriarchal style of medicine. So thank you so much for everybody for joining us. Before we move on to our Zoom chat, the non-recorded version, which I love, I would love to ask Kai, could you tell us three actionable takeaways that our listeners can implement right away to change their health?
Yes. Yeah, so first one I would say is, make it easy and enjoyable, and just incorporate it, as I touched on earlier, with something that you are already doing in your life. Second thing I would say is start small. The smaller, the better. And then you've always got a baseline that you can easily maintain. And that's always a good starting point, and you'll keep that habit alive. And we touched on it as well. Third thing I'd say is just celebrate the small wins, because it really helps fix in that new behavior that you've got. And it just helps wire that circuit. I'd add a fourth, if that's okay. I touched on it earlier, but our technological, abilities these days have really just out evolved us completely. And I think we really just need to step back, and in order to be, you know, truly comfortable, we need to kind of relearn how to be content at being uncomfortable and make the certain things in life a bit harder, you know, for a reason. Like, do you need to get, you know, Alexa to turn your lights off? Is there anything wrong with actually getting up to just turn the switch off? It's probably really good for you, and it might save your life one day. So you know, I think really simple things like that.
I love that. It's the small things that do add up, exactly, over many, many years. Thank you so much, Kai, for taking the time out of your busy emergency medicine schedule. I know your day shifts, night shifts on top of it. You did the master's degree. Incredible. I don't know how you fit it in. And also joining us on a Sunday, free of your charge, and just to educate, that's really appreciated. If you guys want to connect with Kai, he's on Instagram. We will send a link here onto the Zoom chat and also on YouTube. And of course, if you would like to continue this conversation, you can become a member of Afternoon Tea with docs.com. There, this conversation continues on a supportive community setting. Also, if you like this chat, please share it. It's on YouTube right now. You can click the share button and subscribe so that you can learn more about lifestyle medicine and how it can save you from chronic diseases on the long run. Thank you so much for joining us today. We hope to see you next Sunday at 5 p.m. Have a good Sunday. See you.
Thank you.